So welcome back. So in the last class, hope you all go through the last portions we have taken in the last class. So this is the last slide we have stopped in our previous class. So we'll continue from here. So in the previous class, we were discussing about the conditions responsible for personality change. Now today we will see each one and one by one in detail. So the first point is physical change. The physical changes that are resulting from maturation, structural disturbances in the brain, organic disorders, or any endocrine disorders. So such physical changes will sometimes accompanied by the personality changes also. So second is changes in environment. The environment is also have a great influence in the personality change. When some changes in the environment comes, it will improve the child status in the peer group or the same group. So it has a favorable effect on the self concept also. So next is changes in significant people. So the important personalities were the children looking forward or they actually such significant people's attitude, their belief or their thought, that will also influence, that will also help to change the personality of that individual. Next is changes in social pressure. The stronger the drive for social acceptance, the more child will try to develop personality quality. That is, the social acceptance is very important. So slowly the child will learn what all qualities in behavior is accepted or disliked by the society. So according to that, for getting a social acceptance, the child will change his or her behavior in a positive way. Next is changes in a role. That is a change from a subordinate to a leadership role in the home, school. That will also improve the child's self-concept. So so that's all about the changes in roles. Then next is changes in the next is a strong motivation. The motivation is another important thing, because the parent or teacher who motivate the child, so from that the child will understand that which is the good quality in the character, which is the good quality for getting the social acceptance. So such motivation is also help the child for changing his or her personality. For ordinary people is a more easily will change their personality by giving motivation. Now next is the changes in a self concept. As we learned in the previous slide, that the self concept is one of the important core in the personality pattern. So bringing changes in the self concept is also help to bring a change in the individual personality. Now next is types of personality. There are three types of personalities there: extrovert, introvert, and ambivert. So extrovert personality, they has the tendency to live mostly outside. They like to live with others. They want to join other groups who are more in number. In introvert personality, that is exactly opposite to the extrovert personality. So those people are always live alone in their rooms and do not want to go outside. They have their own imaginary world. The last one is ambivert personality. It comes between these two personality. That is our third one type. The people belong to this type enjoy both the groups and attend them. Now we will see what are the determinants of the personality. So the first one is influence of the biological factors, culture, and family. So here, the influence of the biological factor, culture, and family is something very important which is one of the important determinant of the personality. Because biological factors meet the inherent and characters. The culture is a another important thing. We can see that normally it has been said that you can take children away from their culture, but you cannot take the culture away from the children. So in every culture, children are subjected to pressure to develop a personality pattern. So that will conform to the standard set by the culture. Next is inherited predispositions. So everyone has noticed that a striking differences that will exist among each infants, because one baby is extremely active in the world, another is sluggish, and one cries. So the babies are different. So sometimes the mother will consult the pediatrician to see if anything is wrong with my baby. Actually, sometimes this difference in the personality of infant had to do with diet or temporary physical conditions, but sometimes they do not. So they seem to indicate a strong genetic influences. So role of inheritance also, it show up as strongly in the incidence of certain behavior disorders also. Next is ability. A person ability, that is also another important quality of his personality. So being brought up, for example, it's a personality character. In fact, intelligence is a very important quality that can be measured when other quality are in doubt. A person's ability, it also influences his personality by providing him with a means of gaining recognition, because recognition is a very important thing. So intelligence and special abilities that permit children and adults, as well as to develop competence from which they acquire confidence and also self-esteem. Next is social learning. That is, we need to learn from the society. We need to observe. So observational learning or a modeling in which a person that will acquire a response to a situation, he will understand what response will we need to give for a particular situation. So that is what you mean by a social learning. Next is classical conditioning. The responses most often conditions are emotional responses. So conditional fears are often characteristic way of behaving in certain situations. For example, if a mother says to her child, "The Negroes are dirty," which repeated a few times, the conditions the child to have a negative response to the black. Okay, so such things are called, such is one example for the classical conditioning. So many words that carry negative unpleasant meaning, for example, like dirty, nasty, terrible. So when such words are when we paired it with a certain events, the emotional attitude is connected with the word that become attached to the events. Next is operant condition. So many personality characteristics are acquired through operant condition. For example, if a child who throws a temper tantrum with the attention or with a lollipop, the behavior tends to be learned, and later in life the child is likely to show signs of temper tantrum whenever he wants something. So that is what we call is operant conditioning. So classical and operant conditions are such, they are situational based determinants. So next is modeling. Human beings learn their characteristics ways of behaving not only through classical and operant condition, but also through the essentially human means of modeling, or through the observational learning. Next is family influence. Family is also very important for all environmental influences in shaping of personality. So the family can offer reward and also give punishment through which characteristics responses are acquired. So learning in the family, normally a child's parents are the first teacher he has. Next is parental attitude and the self-concept. The parents who are themselves well adjusted off, who love and respect their child, gave him a feeling of self-worth and self-confidence. So with their praise and love, they help him to regard himself as a desirable person. Next is modeling in the family. A child's parents are his first model as well as his first teacher. So child learn both general attitude and specific responses by using their parents as models. So in the process of modeling, children copy many of their personality characteristics of their parents. Last one is social influence. Our culture and subculture that vary according to the atmosphere we live in, the city or in a village, in an upper or a lower economic class. Whenever each culture has its distinctive value, so morals and ways of behaving. Thus, culture influences personality through a process. So that is what we call a socialization. So these are the various determinants of a personality. So the next part of the chapter is adjustment. The concept of adjustment is originated from the biological term adaptation. So in biologically, we call adjustment as an adaptation. Hope you all are familiar with the word adaptation. For example, if you are moving to a new place, if you are next week, you are going to a new college, you are getting an admission after your degree, you are getting an admission for PG in some college which is very, very far away from your current college. So it's a new place. So you are meeting a new teacher. So it is entirely a new environment for you. So slowly, slowly, you are getting adapted to the new situations. You are getting adjusted to the new situation. So that is simply what is adjustment. But psychologists use this term for varying conditions. The adjustment means the reaction to the demand and pressure of a social environment that imposed upon the individual. So that is the definition given by the psychologist for the adjustment. So here are some definitions. So James Drewer, he defined adjustment. It means the modification to compensate for or meet a special needs. Another definition given by the Schaffer, he's the defined adjustment is the process by which a living organism maintains a balance between its needs and circumstances that influence the satisfaction of these needs. So adjustment is the interaction between a person and his environment. How one adjusts in a particular situation upon one's personal character and also the circumstance of the situation. So psychologists have viewed the adjustment from two important perspectives. One is adjustment as achievement and another is adjustment as a process. So first, adjustment as achievement means how efficiently an individual can perform his duties under different circumstances. So whatever may be the circumstance, the individual give his best performance or he will be work efficiently to give his good results. Next is adjustment as a process. That explains the way and mean of an individual's adaptation to his self and environment without reference to the quality or outcome. So he's not bothering about the quality and the outcome of his duty, but he is adapting to his self and environment to do his duty. So that is the two perspective of adjustment which is given by the psychologist. Now, a well-adjusted person considers every new situation has a challenge and meet it with intelligence, courage, and wisdom. So, another definition for the adjustment. So, a well-adjusted person, he's always considering every new situation. The person who can adjust at any situation, he will consider all situation as a challenge and meet it with intelligent courage and wisdom. So, now characteristics of a well-adjusted person that include aware of his own strength and weakness, respecting himself and others, an adequate level of aspirations, satisfaction of basic needs, absence of critical faulty finding attitude, flexibility in behavior, the capacity to deal with adverse circumstance, a realistic perception of the world, a balanced philosophy of life. So these are some characteristics of a well-adjusted person. So this is the last part of this chapter, the hazards in personality development. There are two serious hazards in personality development in late childhood. So first one is the development of a unfavorable self-concept, which leads to the self-rejection. Many children develop unfavorable self-concept. As a result, they have a difficulty in accepting themselves and often become self-rejectant to the point where they make a poor personal and a social adjustment. So they are not comfort to any adjustments. Okay, so here, unfortunately, many parents, teachers, and others responsible for the guidance and the control of children's behavior either do not realize that the children are developing an unfavorable self-concept, or if they do realize it, they feel that this is just a passing phase and that the unfavorable self-concept will correct themselves. So in fact, they tend to grow worse as children grow older unless steps are taken to improve them. So next one is the carryover of egocentrism from early childhood. Egocentrism is serious because it gives children false sense of their importance. Egocentrism means concern about self rather than about others. So egocentric children are self-bound in the sense their interests are centered mainly in themselves. So they think and talk more about themselves than about others, and their acts are designed mainly to bring benefit to them. So this egocentrism is different forms are there that egocentrism based on feeling of superiority, which is characterized by interest in and concern about self as a superior person. And the second type is based on feelings of inferiority. So here the person will turn inward and concentrate on self in the belief that they have nothing of worth to contribute to the group. So that is the second point or second hazard for the personality development. So that's all. So our first module is completing here. So I'll be giving notes in the next class. So please listen the classes not only one time, two or three time. I know most of the students, the subject is very new. So please repeat. You have to hear or you have to listen repeatedly. Okay, then only you can understand. If any doubts or if any concern regarding the class, you can ask in the comment box in the Google class, or you can ask what you can post your comments in WhatsApp, or you can personally also send me the message. Okay, so as of now, I'm winding up my class. So see you all next time. Thank you.